will come 10 minutes, 10 minutes to six, which means 5:15. So 10 minutes, I'll say 6 minutes will be prostrations, and 4 minutes will be lap dance, and we can start at six. Also, tomorrow, 10 to 6. How do you visualize? They are like your mothers, and you come home, been bullied by the elder students in the school, and your mothers, they are just really giving you full love, affection, attention, care, and embrace. This is actually what happens. It is our failure. We will do the mental performance, our feeling to see them, make sure that they are there to give us full love, affection, and care and so forth. Next, quality of the field, we should like to come to our own two signs, all the family members around you, and all the essential beings, living on the side, including the tiny insects, animals. And how do you visualize? Your mother here no longer is one of your children. And you are going to give full love, affection, attention, care, and embrace to the extent that each one of them feels themselves as so special in your arms. And the purpose of this practice is eventually to let manifest the ultimate source of happiness which is within you. The nature, whereby no external conditions can vary you, whereby your happiness is forever guaranteed, and that way you give happiness to all the other sentient beings the way the sun does to every atom of the universe. So, what makes you not experience that is because of the mental imbalance, which has stored this incredibly precious within nature, the precious treasure within us. But obscurations, two kinds, afflictive obscurations and cognitive obscurations. Afflictive obscurations, we saw three kinds, afflictions, contaminated karmas, and the active impairments. And all these three are rooted in the self-grasping ignorance. The moment we exterminate the self-grasping ignorance, all the afflictive obscurations, however numerous they are, will disappear altogether. On the other hand, we have the cognitive obscuration, which is like the self-esteem of the afflictive obscurations. And this self-esteem manifests in the form of self-centered attitude. So now we see that on one hand, we have the self-grasping ignorance and all these options. On the other hand, we have the self-centered action. And the best way by which to remedy the self-grasping ignorance is the wisdom of emptiness. So therefore, the wisdom of emptiness plays a very important role, and it is also referred to as the ultimate Bodhicitta. And on the other hand, we have the self-centered attitude, which can best be remedied by the Bodhicitta. Altruistic mind, wishing to the Buddha for the benefit of all sentient beings. So this Bodhicitta is also referred to as the conventional Bodhicitta. In other words, it is through the practice of these two Bodhicittas, ultimate Bodhicitta, which is the wisdom of emptiness, and conventional Bodhicitta, which is the altruistic intention of love, to wishing to become Buddha for the benefit of all sentient beings. So the practice of these two Bodhicittas that will put the nature ultimate source of happiness can be manifested, and that you are free from all sufferings, and that we can liberate all other sentient beings from suffering likewise. Okay, with that in mind, and imagining that you are leading this group, and all sentient beings are joining you, including your two grandparents and all of your family members. Now let's turn to page 2. Encouraged by your compassion, you are taught an immaculate Dharma to dispel all perverted beliefs. To you, the Buddha will come on our great homage. Encouraged by your compassion, you are taught an immaculate Dharma to dispel all perverted beliefs. To you, the Buddha will come on our great homage. Encouraged by your compassion, you are taught an immaculate Dharma to dispel all perverted beliefs. To you, the Buddha will come on our great homage. In dependent origination, there is no ceasing, no rising, no annihilation, no garments, no mind, no going, no separateness, and no sameness. I prostrate to the Constant Buddhas, the Supreme among all teachers, the one who taught us peace, which is free of annihilations. I prostrate to the Mother of the Buddhas, and of the hearers and those others, who through the knowledge of all these hearers is in aspiration to complete peace, who through the knowledge of past obstacles have been migrated to achieve aims in the world. And through the possession of omniscience, the severest of all the varieties of all aspects. The one who is transformed into the beloved guide and motivated by altruism for better decision days. The teacher is regarded and protector to your frustrations. The one who has eliminated the rebel conceptualizations and is endowed with the divine bodies of the past and the profound. Who eternally shines forth in forever noble life ways, you the Buddha may frustrate. All phenomena arise from causes. The causes are taught by the Bhavana. The cessation of causes as well is taught by the great seer.
By my pilgrimage and your presence and giving and so forth,
May I be in a Buddha to them in all sentient days. I go for refuge and gentlemen righteous to the Buddha, the Dharma, the Sangha. By my privilege and the prayers of the and so forth, may I be in a Buddha to them in all sentient days. So I
unceased, seen as not without sleep, not deficient, not fulfilled.
Shariputra, therefore, emptiness, there is no form, no feeling, no discrimination, no causal factors, no consciousness, no eye, no ear, no nose, no tongue, no body, no mind, no vision form, no sound, no odor, no taste, no object of touch, and no phenomena. There is no eye element and soul, no two, including no mind element, and no matter consciousness element. There is no ignorance, no extinction of ignorance, and so on, up to and including no aging and death, and no extinction of aging and death. Similarly, there is no suffering, no origination, cessation, and harm. There is no form of wisdom, no attainment, and also no non-attainment. Because there is no attainment, bodhisattva should ride along and dwell in the professional wisdom, the mind without observation, and thus without fear. Having completely passed through an era, there is an empire of Bhavana. All the Buddhas who dwell in three times also manifest a complete awakening, unsurpassable, perfect, complete enlightenment, and reliance on the professional wisdom. Therefore, the mantra of the professional wisdom, the mantra of great knowledge, unsurpassed mantra, the mantra of evil divine reward, the mantra that calmly pacifies all suffering, should be known as truth since it is not false. The mantra of the professional wisdom is declared. Train in the profound professional wisdom like that, then the Bhagavan arose from that concentration and commanded the Bodhisattva Mahasattva, saying, well said, it is like that, it is like that. One should practice the profound professional wisdom just as you indicated. Even the Tathagata rejoiced, the Bhagavan having thus spoken, then the Bodhisattva, the Bodhisattva Mahasattva, those that are in the entirety and over the world of gods, humans, asuras, and animals, were overjoyed and highly praised as spoken by the Bhagavan. And as we sign this mantra, I remind you, imagine the Bodhicitta is exhorting us that don't remain in samsara, don't remain in the anxiety, the fear, the pain of samsara. Come towards me, come towards enlightenment. And rise above these things. And hearing these melodious voices in the Bodhicitta, you then inspire your true companions, all of the members, all sentient beings. Look, this is what our great compassionate teacher, Bodhicitta, is exhorting us as following, that we should not remain in samsara. Why should we be in the fears and the cries and the tears of samsara? That is all go towards the other source of happiness, through this path. And all the dear sentient beings hearing your voice, they are so happy to go and come along with you towards ultimate happiness through the wisdom of emptiness and through the Bodhicitta. With the mind that's recited 7 times. And you are doing this, and all sentient beings are joining you. And all those bodhisattvas, they are so affectionately, so lovingly just watching us what we're doing. inner and outwardly the spiritual storm, may they be destroyed, may they be nothing, may they be satisfied, may all negative forces opposed to Dharma be completely pacified, may the host of 80,000 of sins be pacified, may we be separated from the arrogance and delicious comfort of the Dharma, may all enjoyments be departed from the Dharma, may all auspiciousness and perfect happiness pervade this place and now. It was my training. With the determination to achieve the highest aim, for the benefit of all sentient beings, we surpass the need of wishful thinking gem, the holy tear of all tournaments. Whenever I interact with someone, may view myself as the wisdom of the Lord, and from the very depths of my heart, respectfully hold others as superior. In all my deeds, may I flow into my mind, and as soon as mental and emotional afflictions arise, as they endanger myself and others, then strongly defend them and avert them. When I see beings of unpleasant character, oppressed by strong agony and suffering, may I hold them dear, for they are very refined, as if I have discovered the true treasure. When others are with jealousy, treated wrongly with abuse, slander, and scorn, may I take upon myself that to eat and offer to others the victory. When someone whom I have helped, on whom I have placed great hopes, mistreats me in extremely hurtful ways, may I regard and still respect my precious teacher. In brief, may I offer benefit and joy to all my mothers, both directly and indirectly, may quietly take upon myself all the hurts and pains of my brothers. May all this remain undefined by the stains of the eight material concerns, and may I recognize all things as illusions, devotedly be released from bondage. Okay, the next to boost our self-confidence. From my two collections, vast space that I've amassed, when working with after that this practice for a great length of time, may I become the chief in Buddha for all those whose minds with some eyes blinded their appearance. Okay. The seventh vision, page 22. A seventh vision, there are so many kinds, there are so many versions, like associated with Guru Sambhava, associated with Aravind Krishpala, associated with Bodhicitta, associated with Aravind Jushri, associated with Namasunapa, and so forth. There are so many different kinds. And earlier, okay, so then slowly I picked up this one. This one, this is directly from the Sutra. And the deity to be invoked is not just one particular deity, but all Buddhas and Bodhisattvas, particularly Buddhas. The all Buddhas, they invoke the Buddhas, not just one particular, from one particular tradition, to make it very embracing all the tradition being neutral, or which embraces all traditions. Okay. Now, whereas if you follow a particular teacher, and the teacher applies to any Indian culture, you follow that. And there's nothing wrong with it. Idea is to say, to trigger someone this path, to take this journey, we need to purify mind, and we need to energize our mind with merits. So the very purpose of doing the seventh puja is to accomplish that, the purpose, to purify the abilities and accomplish the merits. So, and what we have this is here is extracted from the extraordinary aspiration of the practice of Samyabhatra from the sutra. So, as we recite sentences, just see that the words, try as much as possible to invoke their respective experiences. Just invoke their respective experiences as we recite the lines. And you see that there is the emphasis on each of the 7 points, making prostrations, and making offerings, the profession, rejoicing, and so forth. All these points, 7 points will come one after another. Okay. With that in mind, let's read them. As we read them, more important thing is mental feeling that. And where you're supposed to make offering, for example. Just imagine that you're everything that exists in this universe, you're making offering. Rather than simply saying words. We say this, but mentally we have to be very active. Okay. I bow down to the beautiful Aramajushri. You will dine for consumers, born to freedom in the present, past, and future. In the words of 10 directions, to all of you with body, species, symbol, and about time, with the energy of aspiration for the world's other way, with a sense of deep respect and with as many bodies as hands in the world. To all the Buddhas, visualize as real about time. On every atom are Buddhas, numberless as atoms, each amidst a host of bodhisattvas. And I'm confident the spirit of all phenomena is entirely filled with Buddhas in this way. With infinite space of prayers for you, and oceans of sound from the ashes of my glories, I seek the breathtaking excellence of Buddhas and celebrate all of you born to bliss. Beautiful flowers and beautiful gardens, sweet music, scent flowers and parasols, sparkling lights and sublime incense are offered to you, victorious ones. Fine dress and fragrant perfumes, sandalwood powder, equal Mahayas Mahamuru, all wondrous offerings in spectacular array offered to you, victorious ones. With transcendent offerings, peerless in class, with profound decoration for all the Buddhas, with strength and conviction in the Bodhisattva way, I offer and bow down to all victorious ones. Every heart of action I have done with my body's vision mind, overwhelmed by attachment, anger, and confusion, and of peace, I openly lay bare before you. I lift my heart and rejoice in all the merit of the Buddhist Bodhisattvas in 10 directions. Of solitary answers, here is still training and goes beyond, and of all ordinary beings. You who are the bright light of the world's in 10 directions, who have attained the Buddha's omniscience through the stages of awakening. All you who are my guides, please turn to the supreme will of God. With palms together, I earnestly request you who may enter us by your Bhavana, please stay with us for an aeon's numberless actions in the world, for the happiness and well-being of all wanderers in samsara. Whatever is my merit I may have created by paying homage, offering and acknowledging my faults, rejoicing in the profession that the Buddha has stayed and teach, I am now dedicating all this for the full awakening for all days. Okay, the mandu offering. Just if you know how to do this hand gesture of the mandu offering gesture. Okay, how many of you don't know this hand gesture? Okay, how many of you know? Those who know, just put them in, do not know, and be kind to help. Okay, just raise your hands, those who don't know. Draw an arm, do the ear, help. Wing, draw. Okay, anyone else? Just see how difficult it is to teach. Even to teach in just how difficult, then think about teaching emptiness. Okay, very good. So the central figure is Mount Meru. The central one which is standing is Mount Meru. And on four sides, the four sides are the four continents, which is the cosmology, as presented by the classical Indian cosmology. The center is Mount Meru, and the four sides are the four continents. And of course, such a world system as depicted in the classical Indian cosmology does not really hold true, and historical development oftentimes says that such a world system does not exist. So still, we offer is just a gesture. From your side, you don't have to think that, oh, this is really like a world system. No. This is a gesture of offering everything good that exists in this universe to all those world cycles. And particularly for Shankarani, as well as the Dalai Lama, you can say Aramakishpara, Aramajushri, Aramatriya, Aramagajman, and then Lama Selimpa, Achyavita, Shirjana, and all these great teachers, okay, and all those good samples. And you're not just by yourself, all such beings are with you, your two companions and all such beings. Again, with this one, first we will read the English translation, followed by the Tibetan, original Tibetan. This ground, anointed with perfume, trimmed with flowers, adorned with marble, the four continents, the sun and the moon. I imagine this as a foot of air and offer it. May all such beings enjoy this pure land.
Generate the mind that unceasingly day and night takes its essence.
This life is as a permanent as a water bubble. Remember how quickly it decays and death comes. After death, just like a shadow follows the body, the results of which is the knowledge of the common flow. Finding firm and definite conviction in this is that we always to be careful to abandon even the slightest negativity and accomplish all virtuous deeds. Samsara's pendants are unsatisfying and unreliable. Seeking them is the goal of all suffering. Recognizing these shortcomings is destined to generate a strong wish for the bliss of liberation. Led by this pure thought, mindfulness, alertness, and great portion of lives. Like the rule of the king teaches keeping the credit of your vows, it is best to accomplish this essential practice. Just as I've fallen into the sea of samsara, so have all other material beings. It is best to see their training to make Bodhicitta and bear responsibility for obeying my material beings. Even if I dwell in Bodhicitta, but I don't practice the three types of morality, I have not achieved enlightenment. With my clear recognition of this, it is best to practice the most of the power with great energy. Once I've classified distractions to raw objects and correctly analyzed the meaning of reality, it is best to generate quickly in the pure mind stream of the unified power of karma body and special insight. Having become a pure vessel training into eternal power, forced once the supreme vajra of the people. At that time, the basis of accomplishing true attainments is keeping pure vows in samaya. As I become firmly convinced of this, it is best to protect these vows and practice in my life. Then having realized the importance of the two stages, the essence of what you are now, by practicing with great energy, never given the four sessions, it is best to realize the teachings of the Holy Guru. Like that, may the Guru be sure of the Holy Path and the spiritual friends who practice in their own lives. It is best to pass by completely all outer and inner hindrances. In all my lives, never separated from the perfect gurus, may enjoy the magnificent Dharma by completing the qualities of the teachings and hearts, may quickly attain its state of Vajradhara. Okay, if you turn to page 29, page 29 is blank, page 29, stanza 8, which says, even if I develop Bodhicitta, but I don't practice the three types of morality. What are the three types of morality? So the three types of morality are one, morality of refraining from the negative deeds. The morality of refraining from the negative deeds. Negative thoughts, afflictions, and negative actions, negative karmas. The morality of refraining from the negative deeds. One. Number two, morality of gathering virtues. Morality of gathering virtues. Morality of gathering virtues. Number three is morality of engaging in the welfare of the sentient beings. Morality of engaging in the welfare of sentient beings. The three moralities. Morality of refraining from negativities. Morality of gathering virtues. Morality of engaging in the welfare of sentient beings. Morality of engaging in the welfare of sentient beings. Okay, so say morality of refraining from negative beliefs. It means however tiny, however small, insignificant the negativities are, negative thoughts, negative actions, try your best. Don't neglect them. Don't neglect, make sure that you refrain from the negativities. This is morality of refraining from negativities. For example, like the 10 non-virtuous karmas. Refrain from 10 non-virtuous karmas. Then the morality of gathering virtues. Any virtue, however small it is, let us not ignore, let us not neglect. However small virtue is, this is what we have to just rejoice. We have to feel joyous about embracing this virtue. So it's so important. So this way you build a habit, you build a habit of gathering virtues. Then number three is morality of engaging in the welfare of the sentient beings. Finally, particularly following the Bodhisattva path, following the Bodhisattva path, following the Mahayana path, our job is eventually to become Buddha for the benefit of all sentient beings. to engage the benefits of today. So any virtue or any say morality associated with helping the sentient beings, we are not to neglect them, we are not to procrastinate them. We are to just try to embrace them as soon as possible. So these are the three realities. So I say some are what we have intellectually built and some we have to apply in a day-to-day life. Okay. So these three realities are something which is so practical and which will take us away, which will make us move from the Gati, Parasamadhi, Bodhisattva. Okay. And then in page 30 it says that stanza 11, at that time the basis of accomplishing the two attainments are the mundane attainments and the supramundane attainments. Mundane attainments and the supreme attainments. A mundane, which consists of, say, because of the practice of very powerful samadhi, you can, as a byproduct, you can achieve powers such as ability to read others' minds, ability to fly in the sky, ability to dive into the earth, ability to walk on the water. So these abilities can be achieved, but these abilities are considered as mundane abilities, mundane siddhis. And the super mundane siddhis is when you start going from gati, actual traversing along the path towards Buddhahood. So that is the supreme attainments in the form of achieving Buddhahood, in the form of achieving immeasurable, in the form of achieving many clarity, Yudhishthira Bhano. So just hear these words, even hearing these words, meaning clarity, Yudhishthira Bhano, you know, what are these? So these are known as the supreme siddhis, supreme power, supreme attainments, right? So this will be said, the surface of the body we can achieve, the body that we have is so gross, surface of the body we can achieve. The body where you can manifest yourself like, say, infinite manifestations, emanations. And the body which can travel towards one world system to the other world system so easily. So there's one particular body, a specialized body known as the illusional body. So this is achieved through a very advanced level of practice. And then the meaning came out of mind. The body with the body and mind. And the surface of the body is known as the illusion body, and the surface of the mind is known as the meaning clarity. So, if you achieve these qualities, these two qualities, it's guaranteed that you're going to become Buddha within this very lifetime. Right? When you achieve these two qualities, illusion body and meaning clarity, it is guaranteed that you're going to become Buddha within this very lifetime. Okay. And then, what else? Any words we can use which you. Okay, in stanza 12, then having realized the two stages. What are the two stages? This is in line with tantra practice. The two stages. One is the generation stage, another one is completion stage. Generation stage, and the completion stage, the two stages. Okay. And the Bodhicitta is not yet written, which means the book is still in the draft form. Okay. Now the next stanza, page 32. This is page 32. Down is the most, the hardcore, the essence of the practice, which we are embrace as a part of our life practice. So this is known as generated the mind of Kamsun Yoga in Tibetan, Hamche Nyajoli Senkeva. Hamche Nyajoli Senkeva, Tibetan version. And in English, it is generated the mind of Kamsun Yoga. And many people in university will say in Bhajan practice. Many people just call it Bhajan practice. Okay, if possible, Padun Singh Federation, Hamche Yanjuri Singh Kirba. So, what happens was that His Holiness the Dalai Lama, whenever he gives Tantra initiations, he does this practice. He gives this practice to the participants. And then Amir asks, oh, this practice is so good. Why this practice should be confined to Tantra? Why don't we do this on a daily basis? So then this is included as a new practice. From what we're going to do, you'll see that this is the final essence of the practice which we're going to do. And this is going to be the great spending of our life. Okay, with this mind, so this is going to be more the form of guided meditation. Guided meditation. And we will follow it orally. And then later on, at home, in your room, we just browse through it. What is there? So this is much more same as what I'm going to already guide you. So basically, this practice should have the same, should have four aspects. One is, initially we're going to do the shamatha meditation, single point meditation, very quickly, single point meditation. Next one is renunciation practice. Renunciation on the basis of the four seals. On the basis of the practice of the four seals. Renunciation. Then number three is bodhicitta. Then number four is the wisdom of emptiness. Right? Wisdom of emptiness. So these are the four things we're doing. Then later on, you through your own personal interest, personal practice, when you're able to see that these four are coming to a good shape, these four practices, shamatha, renunciation, bodhicitta, wisdom of emptiness. When you see that these four practices, they start in good shape, then you can include tantra. You can include tantra in this. So, total five. Shamatha, renunciation, bodhicitta, wisdom of emptiness. So, when I explain, I may explain in different ways. Renunciation, bodhicitta, wisdom of emptiness, shamatha. I may explain like this, but in our practice, for our same convenience, we do the shamatha first. Okay, otherwise, there's no hard fast rule. But then the other three, renunciation, bodhicitta, wisdom of emptiness, this the order is fixed, and there's a reason. Renunciation, bodhicitta, wisdom of emptiness. And you may see in some text, wisdom of renunciation, then wisdom of emptiness. And in other words, in some other text, wisdom of emptiness comes first, followed by renunciation, bodhicitta. But here, for a specific reason, we are going to do renunciation first, bodhicitta, wisdom of emptiness. Within renunciation, you will see the wisdom of emptiness also. Right? So, in other words, the wisdom of emptiness comes twice. First, as a part of renunciation. That is to make your renunciation very refined and powerful. The first wisdom of emptiness. So that will come as a part of the renunciation. Then in bodhicitta, then wisdom of emptiness. So that wisdom of emptiness is different from the first one. Wisdom of emptiness per se is the same. But the purpose is different. The first one is to generate renunciation. And the second one is to become a Buddha. Second wisdom of emptiness is for you to become a Buddha. Because you have generated bodhicitta, may I become Buddha for the purpose of being made. Then the question arises, how I will become Buddha? By cleansing my mind. How I will cleanse my mind? By meditating wisdom of emptiness. So the second part of the wisdom of emptiness is meant for you to become Buddha. And the first part, as a part of the renunciation, that is meant to define, to generate a refined version of the renunciation. Right? Okay, this is the difference. Now with that point, that's to say 5 minutes brief meditation. 5 minutes brief meditation. Ready? The posture once more. also body upright and eyes not closed. Body upright and eyes not closed. Okay. And of the four points, body posture, focal point, keep in mind, the two things happen. One is focus your mind on the position between your nose and upper lip. This is the position where you will focus. Meanwhile, multitasking, counting your breath. While you focus your mind here, you also count your breath. Breathe in, breathe out, cycle one, breathe in, breathe out, cycle two. This is how we're going to count the breath. Okay. Then the two most important things, one is identifying the areas of meditation. Mental activity and mental scattering. So in most cases, mental scattering is very likely. Mental scattering. This must be stopped, mental excitement. Otherwise, mental laxity, when you feel the body heavy, mind heavy. So for this, keeping your body alert, keeping your cross-legged, it can help you greatly. And then, point number four is applying remedies. Remedies twofold, introspection and mindfulness. Introspection is just to keep an eye on your mind, to see whether the mind is still on the focal point, or is distracted, or in the next state. Should you see that your mind is distracted, in state of excitement, and laxity, you must apply the remedies of way back, particularly the mindfulness, which is like the road. Okay, so you are not to miss the last two points. Identify areas of meditation and applying remedies. Okay, 5 minutes. Next is the renunciation. A renunciation, yeah. I mean, there's no meaning. Renunciation is to renounce the miseries. And finally, of the various kinds of the miseries, there are miseries which reflect miseries which pervades all of its kind is the loss of freedom. Misery in the form of loss of freedom. When you lose your freedom, this is the greatest misery. This is the greatest misery. So and the loss of freedom can be seen in different ways. Say people fight for human rights, or there is no human rights violation and so forth. It's actually saying that there's a loss of freedom. Likewise, say you have a headache, it's also loss of freedom. Because you don't want headache. And you don't want a headache, you want the freedom of being free from headache, and you don't have that choice. So you have lost it, you have lost that freedom to have or not have headache. So you have it, which means that you don't have the freedom to choose not to have the headache. So likewise we see that all miseries finally can be brought down in the form of the loss of freedom. And loss of freedom, there are so many levels. And the final version of the loss of freedom, what does it mean by loss of freedom? What is misery can be understood only if we get a glimpse of emptiness. So getting a glimpse of emptiness, then we will know exactly what is meant by the success version of the loss of freedom. Okay, so for time, let's say the renunciation is to renounce the miseries. Renounce the miseries along with its causes, along with the causes of miseries. And here, best can be done. The best can be done in terms of cultivating renunciation with the help of the teachings of the Buddha, referred to as the four seals. Four seals of the Buddha's teachings. So what we're going to do is that we're going to do that in the form of a guided meditation. Guided meditation. Okay, so our sit properly is going to be guided meditation. And the job is see how much we can invoke the respective experiences. For time it is going to be guided meditation. And then slowly, you should be able to do that even without someone guiding you. Right? So here, this kind of meditation is known as analytical meditation. Analytical meditation, where you should be very creative, and emptiness is also analytical meditation, but you should be rich in information. Here, rich in information can also be creative. Okay, the four seals. Sit upon and be in the present moment. Just follow instructions as much as you can, and then see how much you can invoke the respective experiences. Okay, the first seal. All composite things are impermanent. Impermanent, the things which we experience, which we see within yourself, outside, in your family, in the world, all these things which are composed of particles, like atoms, and all those things which are composed of the temporal segments of the mind. Temporal segments of mind, these are known as composite phenomena. And all these composite phenomena, they are related to impermanence. And this impermanence is of two kinds, gross impermanence and subtle impermanence. First, we have to reflect on the gross impermanence. Gross impermanence means anything which you saw earlier, which you heard, which you experienced, and then it did not last long, it disappears, it disintegrates. This is known as the gross impermanence. For example, as a beautiful, let's say 2014, whether it was a very beautiful year or say whatever it might be, now 2015 started and it is gone now. It is gone, now 2016. And likewise, in our life, we have met with many good people and bad people, beautiful sunshine and beautiful times, very happy moments. They're all gone today. They're all gone today. And many who were the same age as ours, who were younger than us, who were older than us, many of them are gone. Now, the same person, in that same physical body, will never meet the person once more as the end. This one is in common. In fact, what we are doing today, likewise, there are so many gatherings happening everywhere, gathering for, say, birthday parties, family gatherings, and then for the indulgences, and then the nightclubs, and so forth. There were so many such gatherings happening. Just now, while we are doing this Bodhicitta Retreat, there are so many such gatherings happening elsewhere. Some very virtuous, some very neutral, some very indulgent, and waste of time, fights, and so forth happening. And what is happening just now? It happened 120 years back in time also. It happened the same thing. Today, those people who are very young, very powerful, very attractive, and very educated, and then say influential, not even a single one of them today, not even a single one of them from 120 years ago is alive today. And as per the world record, the life expectancy is alive today, and it's about 170 years old. Which means what happened 120 years back in time only disappeared today. And 120 years back in time, there are so many people who have so much of plans in their mind. Oh, I have to do this, I have to do that. My son should do like this, my daughter should do like this. So much of plans. Now these plans accomplished, not accomplished. Along with the plans, all these people, the planners were all gone. Not even a single person is there today. And this is the reality of problems. Whether we accept them or not accept them, this is reality. Likewise, what is happening today? One point in time, say about like after 5 years, 10 years, or once we had the Bodhicitta Retreat in Indonesia, the place where the great teacher, Bodhicitta teacher, Damdul was born. So it became a memory one day. And then after 20 years, after 30 years, maybe one or two of us are left then. Oh, many years ago, we had a very memorable Bodhicitta Retreat here in the place of Bodhicitta in Indonesia. Okay, so this is what's going to happen. And then 120 years in the future from today, not even a single person born today, who's alive today, will be then there. This is impermanence. This is the reality of impermanence. Just invoke this experience. However powerful, however rich, however young, however future the person is today. Whether you have plans accomplished, not accomplished, along with the plans, every single individual person today will disappear after 120 years in the future. It is for sure. Just invoke that experience. The truth of this fact. This is what the Buddha referred to as all compulsive in the same moment. It is also good to, while we are here in Indonesia, while we are here in Bali, while we are in this Bodhicitta Retreat, see one of the moments which is so pleasant to you, so healing to you, so appealing to you, don't forget those moments. Don't forget those moments. Tell yourself that this moment that I'm enjoying is also impermanent. If I don't believe, let me see after 10 days. Let me see after 10 days. Experience the beautiful experience that you're having today will disappear. Just tell yourself. And then after 10 days, when you see that it disappeared, it gives such an experiential effect in your mind of the impermanence. And yet this experience has a tremendous effect in your spiritual progress, spiritual growth. This realization will help us to cut down our obsession to this life. Instead, it'll help us to maintain a balance between taking care of this life and taking care of the future lives. Taking care of the material resources which sustain us, and taking care of the spiritual resources which will sustain us in the future towards enlightenment. Okay, so this impermanence is possible only if this cross impermanence underscores the self-impermanence. Self-impermanence is even without the object decaying. Just now, we see that the object is momentarily disintegrating. If you look at a body, moment by moment, nanosecond by nanosecond, the body is changing. From the point of view of physics, a body is made of atoms, and atoms, they do not remain static on the electrons. They are constantly in flux of movement. Likewise, our mind, which is constantly in flux of movement. So this self-impermanence is so fast moving. It is like the timer. It's like how the time passes when we use the timer. See how the digits, they move so fast. This is exactly how our body moves, how our mind moves. It is as though like we are thrown into a very fast moving train. Very fast moving bullet train. And if somebody throws us here, then we become so apprehensive, we become so nervous. And so where is this train taking us? It's moves so fast. Faster the train moves, more fear will come to us. Where is my train taking us? So who decides where we are going? Whether this train is taking us to the picnic spot, or this train is taking us to the slaughterhouse. It's all determined by the driver of the train. And in our case, the driver is our mind. And this mind, depending on under whose influence this mind is operating, that determines whether we're going to do it towards the picnic spot or the slaughterhouse. Unfortunately, in our case, our mind is driven by and influence of the self-grasping ignorance and self-centered attitude, which are so vicious. And these two minds are so vicious, so cunning and so vicious. Because these two attract only miseries in us. So therefore, it is so scary that this very fast moving train mind, the body and the self, it is being taken towards the slaughterhouse, towards the dead, towards the next one. And what the next one is to be like, this sub-grasping and sub-centered energy will only throw us into such unpredictable miseries in the future. And it's not just once, it's just endlessly many. Think of those people enhancing their chance. They can't predict even the next minute, anytime they can go from they can leave this world. So much fear. Likewise, the poor animals in the slaughterhouse. Likewise, those in the hospices, in the hospitals, suffering from cancer, suffering from the AIDS, and waiting for the last breath. So just imagine all these pains. And it's not that we are special. So anytime, sometimes we can be on the top of the ocean. Sometimes you can just go deep down the ocean. So it's just a matter of time. We're also in this line. Okay, it's very scary. It's very scary. This is known as all contaminated things are of suffering nature. Anything is contaminated by the two demons, self-grasping appearance and self-centered attitude, combined together giving rise to all the disturbing emotions, attachment, anger, jealousy, competitiveness, fear, anxiety, depression, so forth. The experience that we go through is only influence. All contaminated things are of suffering nature. And this experience of the suffering is, we have no choice. It's just incessantly, it will continue in the next lives. It is like a very sad movie being projected, and this sad movie being projected over and over again, played over and over again, endlessly. It is so exhausting, how exhausting it is. An experience of sickness, aging, death, losing your dear ones. This is all what we have to go through. And we will endlessly go through in the future as well. It's so exhausting. How exhausting. Okay. Is there a way out? Yes, of course there's a way out. This is known as looking for a permanent freedom from suffering. And what makes us to go through this suffering, what makes us to go through this loss of freedom is the self-grasping ignorance, which creates this dream. Involuntarily, this dream is created by the self-grasping ignorance. And then we are being swayed, tossed up and down into miseries, endless miseries by this dream. How to bring an end to this dream of the samsara? Simply wake up from the state of ignorance. How to wake up from the state of ignorance? It is only through, just as the darkness can be eliminated by introducing the light, it is only through introducing the light of the wisdom that the darkness of self, that the darkness of ignorance can be eliminated. How do you introduce the light of the wisdom? By the very definition, the wisdom is any discerning mind whose apprehension of the object tells you reality. What is reality? Reality is, as the Buddha indicated in the third seal, everything is of the nature of emptiness and selflessness. Okay, now let's meditate on this nature, what is known as, popularly known as the emptiness experience, the wisdom of emptiness, which the Buddha put in the form of the third seal. Everything is of the nature of emptiness and selflessness. Okay, we could meditate on the self, emptiness of self, to wake up from this state of ignorance. Okay, what are you doing? I'm meditating. Okay, so this self, which you think is meditating, does it exist like a dream, like a movie projected by the projector, or it is independent of your mind as a projector? Of course it is independent. This is deception. This is like a small child watching a horror movie and seeing that as 100% existing from the object, existing objectively, and 100% independently of the projector. This is deception. So this is a movie created, and this young child fails to identify that as a movie and takes that as real. Likewise, in that case, we are like small children with respect to see the self as objectively meditating, objectively solving the ear, which is totally deceptive. We have to wake up from this sleep of ignorance. How can we wake up? Okay. Reinforce the visualization, reinforce this perception of the self. I'm meditating. And how does this self appear to exist? As like a movie, as like a dream, or not at all like a dream? Oh no, not at all like a dream. This is known as objective existence created by the self-grasping feelings. This is deceptive. How can I know that this is deceptive? Okay. This meditation, some of you, it may be very new, don't worry. This is going to be the initial step, and this will be of great help eventually. Okay. So, how do I know that this self that I'm meditating, this self which is meditating, is dreamlike? It is empty from the object. So, if it does exist from the object, instead of coming from your mind, if it does exist from the object, the closer we go towards the object, we should be able to find it. Like what Bodhicitta said, if the mirage were to be water, why not those close by the mirage see water? If the mirage were to be water, why not those close by the mirage see water? Okay, in like manner, if this person who is meditating were to exist objectively, why not I see this person as I go closer to his object? Now let us quickly go closer to his object. Let us quickly go closer to his object to see whether this self still exists on the object side. Okay. So going closer to his object, our eye consciousness, we can see this person, is a very gross eye consciousness. It's very gross. To see the person more closely, more to his object, we would use a very refined eyesight. And the best way to find ourselves possibly existing today is the electromicroscope. Imagine that we're using the electromicroscope to go to see to this person more closely towards the object. Through the electromicroscope, what you see? Initially, we see the very fine skin. The skin is not the cell. Just take out all which are not the cell. First, the skin. Skin is not the cell. Inside the skin, when we look through the microscope, and the first we see fatty tissues. Beneath this, we'll see muscles, the skeletons, the blood vessels, the heart, the lungs, the gallbladder, the intestine, the pancreas, the liver, the kidney, and so forth. All these solid parts is not the cell. 100% is not the cell. So these solid parts form the element of earth. And the earth is not the cell. Just remove that element of earth. All the solid parts. Next we see that there is the element of water. The blood which is pumped in and out by the heart. And the world is also not this person. Remove that. Now the element of fire. The body heat. From distance, people can see me, but they cannot see my body heat. So, this body heat is also not me. Remove that. Element fire is also not me. Next, the element of air. The air that I'm breathing out is also not me. Remove that. Next, the element of space. The vacuum that constitutes my body. See, my body is made of millions of atoms, billions of atoms, and the atoms. The space between the nucleus and the electrons is so fast as compared to the size of the electrons and protons and neutrons. So our body is essentially consists of the space. And yet, I'm a sort of person that space is vacuum in nature. Even the element of space is also not to remove that. Now what is left? Only my mind is left. My mind. It is also not me, because I am a male, I am a female. My mind does not have a gender. Gender is posited on the basis of my body. So therefore this mind is also not me. Remove that. What is left now? Now you have gone closest to the object. What is left there? Nothing is left here. So where is that person who was meditating earlier? is gone, is empty, he disappeared. Just crack an experience that this person who I thought earlier meditating is empty. Just crack the experience that it disappeared. And the disappearance of this person, it is not a mental fabrication. It's a fact. It's a fact. It's a fact. What do we see that this person disappeared is a fact. Now bring back the six elements, the solid form, element of earth, element of water, element of fire, element of air, element of space, element of consciousness. Imagine that we are seeing all these six simultaneously, and none of these is the person. And these six, they are almost so independent from one another. It is like six people put together, bound together by a rope. And there's all the six people, they're trying to get away from each other. There's no one common feature which combines them together, or which is known as the person which unifies all the six. No, there's nothing. It's all just six independent people. Likewise, the six elements that we have, they are like the six elements, the independent people, and these six are brought together, bound together by karma. And there's no one unifying force as a person which pervades all these six. What we see as one person pervading all six elements, it is simply illusion. What is seen now? Two questions. Question one, what is seen now? I'm just seeing six elements. Second question, where's the person? This person disappeared. It is empty. So, of the two, seeing the six elements, you are seeing the isolated of the six elements. Then the second question, where's the person? The person is empty, the person disappeared. You are seeing the isolate of the emptiness of the person. Of the two isolates, use the first isolate to get to the second one and focus on the second one. Emphasize on the second isolate, that this person disappeared. Abide in this experience for a while. Okay. Now imagine you remove the electron microscope. What happened to the person? Oh, the person comes back. Again, the person is meditating. This is what comes to your mind. Yet, you again reintroduce the electron microscope. Again, the person disappears. Remove the electron microscope. Again, the person comes back. So there's a constant change happening. Person disappeared, coming back, disappeared, coming back, disappeared, coming back. And on the object side, there's no change. But something's changing. That's purely on the subject side. So whatever is involved in this change, this is purely subjective. So the person, appearance, this is purely on the subjective level. So, remove the electron microscope. Oh, again the person comes back. This is purely subjective. What do you mind? What do your mind appears? Like a dream. Dream is simply from the outer side, it is empty. It simply appears to your mind. Therefore, it is described as a dream. Likewise, in this person, it's also like a dream. It appears to my mind, but from the outer side, it is purely empty. Okay. Abundance experience that this person is empty, that this person disappeared. Okay, you may be wondering, what is the benefit of this meditation? This meditation is known as meditation on emptiness. What is the benefit of this meditation? Yes, there's a benefit. There's a tremendous benefit. The benefit is like, say you are dreaming and you dreamt of being chased by a ghost. You had a nightmare. And then your mother wakes you up. The moment you wake up, the nightmare stops. The fear dissolves. Because you realize that in the dream, the content of the dream, the ghost, in the dream, there was so much fear because you thought that the ghost was real from the opposite side. The moment you wake up, you realize that it is empty from logic, is simply coming from the mind, simply coming from the subject. So the moment you realize that it is coming from the subject, you realize that it is empty from object or it is empty from it is empty in true sense. So this experience that it is empty from the object side, this removes all of fear. So it removes all the fears of sickness, aging, death, miseries, stress, depression, and so forth. So this is known as transcending your sorrow. The moment you transcend your sorrow, all your miseries, all your fears drop, all your mental disturbances drop. That is, the dropping of mental disturbances is known as a peace. So the Buddha taught the fourth seal, transcending your sorrow is absolute peace. Upon this experience of the peace, imagining that experience of the peace of Nirvana. Okay. Now, with this mind, so today, with the same time, we will just, as auspicious sign, we will actually, after this, we should be doing the meditation on the four nationals as a part of the Bodhicitta of kindness. Now what we'll do is that we will do the just the first immeasurable, which is the second immeasurable compassion. Okay, for this matter, just sit properly and follow the instructions as much as you can and then go the experiences. Okay. Reinforce the visualization of all what is both sounds in front of you. So I've actually been so lovingly watching you witnessing what's happening today. And you are surrounded by your two grandparents, all your family members, and all the other social beings. And you are doing this meditation. With your Buddhist mind, immeasurable compassion. How good would it be that all my dear mother social beings are free from suffering? And the causes of suffering. The causes of suffering primarily consisting of self-grasping ignorance and self-centered attitude. May all my dear mother sentient beings be free from suffering and the causes of suffering. I will take the responsibility that all my dear mother sentient beings are free from suffering and the causes of suffering. The Buddhist Bodhisattvas, witnessing that you make such a gracious commitment, like mother for the first time hearing her eldest daughter, hearing her eldest son making commitment to the mother, mother, please take rest. I'm already grown up. I'll take your father and say that you have done everything for us till now. You have done everything. Now I'm grown up. I'll take off all my siblings, you mother, please take rest. For the first time, your mother, after all these many years of hardships, raising the children, for the first time, she is hearing something so pleasant from her eldest daughter, from her eldest son, that he is taking the responsibility of the sibling, and you to take rest. Imagine for the first time, you are hearing such a pleasant thing, and such a joy comes to your mind. And the tears roll down. This is exactly what has happened to all those bodhisattvas, seeing that they are making such a gracious commitment, they are intensely happy and intensely proud of you. And this problem happens that they today invokes their compassionate initial minds to send for mentors and their sweeping light schools and all the other sentient beings. The mere touch of the lights and the mentors with the bodies and means yours. Washes away all miseries, washes away all the causes of miseries, and instills in all happinesses, instills in all causes of happinesses, particularly the wisdom of emptiness and the bodhicitta which cherishes the others more than oneself. And you witnessing such a miracle has happened to us all the day in such days, we're just happy. They treat you grants some relief. okay, this is the unconditional love that you attain, which is all the table sentient beings. Abiding is the unconditional love for a while. And imagine that all the table sentient beings, they're so happy that you attain such unconditional love to each one of them, to the extent that each one of them feels themselves as so special in your arms. Okay, with this in mind, now with folded hands, that is when the commitment of Bodhicitta. I'll say this line, and we'll all say this 3 times together. And feel it wholeheartedly. It's so auspicious. The place where the great enlightenment was after Lama Sevipa was born, and we are doing this practice here. And it's very auspicious, very holy land. May I become Buddha for the benefit of all my dear mother sentient beings. May I become Buddha for the benefit of all my dear mother sentient beings. May I become Buddha for the benefit of all my dear mother sentient beings. Abide in this gracious commitment for a while. And should there be anything which the offering which could bring all those bodhisattvas the happiest is your practice of the Bodhicitta. And today you did it. And from tomorrow we will do the complete form. Okay. We'll end with the dedication prayer. Please turn to page 43. So this Bodhicitta which we practice, and from tomorrow onwards we are going to practice it in a complete form, new form. So it's say this great, the great master, Lama Sevipa, who was born on this, in this nation, Indonesia, and then it was in the 11th century AD, and then say, we don't know how long it lasted. And then, at one point, it disappeared. Now imagine, in this Indonesia, the place where this greatly enlightened Bodhicitta master, Lama Sevipa, was born. And now, we can hardly imagine that this Bodhicitta is going to be practiced in this very land where this Bodhisattva, the Bodhicitta master, Lama Sevipa, was born. And yet, under the leadership of TBC, Tibetan Buddhist Center, inspired by His Holiness the Dalai Lama, we are getting this opportunity to rekindle this Bodhicitta, the Dorji Bodhicitta, in this very land where this great Bodhicitta master, Lama Sevipa, was born. It's so auspicious that we are doing this here in Indonesia. So, may this life of the Bodhicitta, may this life of the wisdom of emptiness flourish in all 10 directions, the way Lama Sevipa did. May these two lights be rekindled in the minds of all demon sentient beings, so that the darkness of ignorance, self-grasp of ignorance, and the darkness of samsara attitude are eliminated from the minds of all the Indonesians here and all the beings in your own countries, and in the entire universe, so that if they experience eternal happiness, eternal bliss, not even hearing the word misery, not hearing even the word fear. May His Holiness the Dalai Lama, the true source of joy and happiness on this earth, today long, and that is wishes to fulfill spontaneously. And I personally dedicate the merits of this gathered that each one of you, through concerted effort, be able to soon see the dawn of the Bodhicitta, which cherishes others more than oneself, and which might have entrance within yourself, so that each one of you becomes such a reliable guide to lead the infinite dear one soon to place, who is the highest of happiness. So, may the teaching of the Bodhicitta flourish in all directions. May the teaching on the wisdom of emptiness flourish in all directions. With this mind, let's turn to page 43 and dedication prayer. I dedicate the merits thus gathered towards the realization of the decent prayers of Buddhist bodhisattvas of the three times, and to the holding of the doctrine of spiritual insight. May I all times, through the force of this merit, never separate from the four wheels of the mind and the ego, and accomplish all the stages of the path, renunciation, bodhicitta, perfect degree, and the two stages. For my two questions, master's faith that I have amassed the work at the presence of a great length of time, man can achieve the living Buddha for all those whose minds respond and their ignorance. Okay, and the first, page 44, the second line, never separate from the four wheels of the mind and the ego. What are the four wheels? Okay. One, four wheels of the Mahayana, four wheels of Mahayana. One is meeting with very authentic Mahayana teachers in future lives. Meeting with authentic Mahayana teachers in future lifetimes. Number two, meeting with conducive factors for Mahayana practice. Meeting with conducive factors for Mahayana practice. Number three is having enormous accumulation of merit. And number four, the direction of proper aspiration. Meaning that in future lifetimes, that you be directed towards the place where Mahayana practitioners are here. And this will take the year. What we take there is your aspirational prayers that you be endowed with abundance of aspirational prayers to take birth in the places of the Mahayana practices. So why we say Mahayana is not to be Mahayana shortlist. This will turn to the mind. Mahayana simply means a practice whereby your motivation is not only for yourself, your motivation is for the benefit of all sentient beings. In terms of the scope of your aspiration, it is maha, great, for all sentient beings, not just for your personal motivation. So this is what's in my mind. It is nothing to do with, oh, we belong to Mahayana tradition. No. The moment you say, we belong to Mahayana tradition, you belong to Theravada tradition, the moment you say that, you are not Mahayana. Because you are not including others. You are excluding others. So real Mahayana is where you include everybody, right? Theravada, even the non-believers, all other religious believers, just embrace everyone. Let's all go together towards the highest happiness. So if this is the spirit which is coming to you, instead of pushing others, embrace everyone. This is the real spirit of Mahayana. Whereas, oh, I'm Mahayana, you are Hinayana, you are Theravada. The moment you do like this, you are not a Mahayana, you are already Theravada. Not Theravada, I should say, you are already Hinayana. Just selfish person, right? So, this should be our spirit. Okay, so, good. We made three decisions. And then we will take the textbook with you for your breakfast to read the text and the profile.